Third fentanyl?
Third fentanyl.
There's a difference for both.
Yes, so I'll go over here on the visitor team, or the home team. Hey, my name's Dean.
That's a lot, huh?
Okay. Smith, if you need to know the last name. And,
And you guys, you saw the seat and,
Shut that down. Hey, Ron.
There's a chair over here too, guys. And I will, I have to.
Okay, my name's Keith, I'm the founder of Sansiv. Sansiv is the Surrey area network of substance users. I put that on the board for all the people that are new faces there. Welcome. You know, this is not a place where you come and get cleaned up. This is not a place where, you know, we want you to come, have a little bite to eat, sit here and hear some education about, you know, using drugs or what the barriers are of the day, you know, and health complications, you know. We need to, you know, we talk about all sorts of things here. And so it's sort of like Cole's notes to the drug user, right? So it's like, you know, you get the idea real quick, really short, you know, it's not a long drawn out, you know, and okay. Personally,
thanks
just
for allowing us to join.
Yeah, you can still do what you want, right? We just want you to be alive. Production sort of model. And hey, Grace, how are you?
Yeah.
Yeah, get a plate, get some pizza. Okay, so Ron, where are you?
Here.
Okay, Ron's the president of Sansiv. Okay.
Hello.
Dwayne over here in the back there, he's our new little rookie there. And he's he's our new volunteer. Today we're pretty excited because we have some special guests with us from downtown. Dr. Narupa Goel. Can I see that?
Yeah, right? That's good.
I'm pretty good at it?
Yeah.
I can hardly screw this one up. Dr. Keith. Come on. Okay. And there, doctor, you're going to lose the phone, mate. Well, no, just turn it off or vibrate. That's good. And so what we're here today, they came out here today to ask about some questions about opioid use and what's going on as they're going to, correct me if I'm wrong, working with a group of doctors, Dr. Evan Wood, who has supported Sansiv since day one, Dr. Thomas Kerr, and a few other name brand doctors, that they're trying to put together a manual or a guide for doctors in BC. So when an opioid user walks into their office, they don't give them two Advil and say, there's the door, you'll be fine in a couple hours. So that they can have some kind of reference material to go to. Sort of like, if this happens, you go to page 5. If this happens after that, you go to page 9. And they kind of work through the book, kind of like, you know, when your phone, tell us about your phone bill, and they kind of work you through the problems with your phone. If that was a problem here, yeah, phone. So, anyways, I have that problem sometimes, and I'm kind of, you know, digitally challenged. So, anyway, without further ado, what they really want to do is hear what you have to say. So they're going to lead in and just sort of tell you a little bit about what they're doing, and then they're going to ask you some questions, and then the floor is going to go back and forth. So, you know, come on in. We'll keep waiting at the back there. She'll get you signed in. Okay, so before we do that, what we traditionally do in Sansu is we go around the room and we ask your first name and how you got here, why you're here. Did you just hear about it 10? Because you got one arm out of a cast.
Yeah, because I like being here. I like being here because I like to learn as well as see everybody.
And Grace went to the first meeting that was held downtown. Yeah, okay.
She was at your
meeting. All right. I'm here for free change.
Ron, we're probably going to need a couple more chairs somehow. All right, and the lady at the table there?
Can I sit here?
I'm going to sit down.
Okay. Sure, I'll just sort of brief background. So Keith and I both work in Vancouver, and one of the big things we're working on and excited is that we're creating this new center. It's called, maybe I'll write this on the board, it's called the BC Center on Substance Abuse. Okay, so it's BCCSU, so it's Center on Substance Use. And
We're going to place the train now.
Well, so it's, I'll tell you a little bit about what the goal of the center is. It's not a clinic or a new hospital or anything like that. It's an organization that is supposed to do more research on substance use, That's one part. And the other part is educating and training physicians and social workers and nurses and all sorts of healthcare providers, and to train them on how to treat patients with substance use using the most up-to-date, most effective, best practices in terms of medical therapies and treatments. And then the third piece is what Keith is going to talk about, which is guidelines and recommendations. So actually writing these documents where we look through all the research and the scientific evidence, and we look at what works best for patients, and we write them down in terms of what the recommendations are, and we give those recommendations to doctors in order to help them figure out how to best manage patients so that people aren't getting, unsafe medications, being sort of left with the door closed behind them without good treatments and things like that. That's a decent summary. So one of our first projects is to write a document that recommends and teaches doctors how to treat patients with opioid use. And we have a document that's kind of already written that was meant, designed for Vancouver Coastal Health, and it's being implemented there. But what our goal is to be a province-wide center that influences care and treatment of patients all over BC. And so we're working really hard to work with doctors all over the province. And so Keith is going to tell you a little bit about that document and what those recommendations are and how we're trying to teach these doctors how to practice their how to practice medicine better and treat patients well and use the most effective treatments.
Yeah. And so just to be clear, we're here to learn from you guys as well as tell you guys about some of the things that we're doing. But the real goal for us is to increase or make better care available to people in BC who use substances, from the whole spectrum of harm reduction all the way through to treatment, to make it as patient-centered as possible. And that means that, you know, just a little story for you guys. My background is I started volunteering at a needle distribution site in 2001. And all the stories hearing from all the clients that came to that needle exchange back in the day, just hearing how terrible they were treated by the healthcare system. And it just was so heartbreaking to hear that, you know, there's such a huge double standard that exists, because it was not like that for me when I would access the healthcare system, and hearing just like stories about not only how people are treated, but just the lack of accessibility of treatment. Months and months to get into detox or treatment centers, and the lack of availability of harm reduction sites, and the fact that there's really only one supervised injection site in all of North America, that's downtown Vancouver, just blows my mind. So our goal really is to change the system of care to make it more centered around you guys. So by going out and doing talks like this, it's really about telling you guys what we're doing to see if it matches the goals that you guys have, and to make sure that we're making the system of care that we're trying to change, we're trying to make sure that we're making it as patient-centered or engaging with you guys as much as possible. So we've gone out and done lots of these type of talks, but your stories are what keep us going, and your stories are what is really the fuel for change. So we want to know about your experiences and what you guys want to see the healthcare system look like, right? Because we're not doing a very good job. Obviously, we're in the middle of a public health emergency, and the fact that we've ended up here, quite frankly, to me is not totally shocking based on how bad the healthcare system is for you guys. So we're here to learn from you guys as well. So we just some, Nerika was giving some background on the guideline. This guideline that we're writing right now, the first thing we're trying to do is really make evidence-based addiction treatment for opioid addiction widely available throughout British Columbia, primarily in family doctors' offices. I think if, you know, any of you have tried to access treatment before, the wait times are just ridiculous. And you're going in and seeing family doctors for getting abscesses and infections treated, and fractures and broken arm treated, and at the same time not getting any addiction care, which is totally, completely unfair and a very, very broken system. We want to change that. So one of the main things that we're recommending in this guideline, has anyone here been to a detox before? Just curious what your experience was like.
It was a pleasant experience.
It was pleasant?
Puking, diarrhea.
Yeah, I know that. I mean, you know.
It was boring.
Was it boring?
Every detox that I've been to is the best, awesome, great patient.
Yeah.
In like a really nice fancy hotel that you can't really go outside. That's the only thing.
But then I'm thinking you get bored, pick up a book, right?
Have any of you guys been to detox specifically for opioids?
Yeah.
Heroin or, yeah. One of the things that we have, a lot of data, a lot of research has shown that when people are admitted to a detox facility and they're locked in that detox facility and we do a super fast taper, 5 days of methadone or suboxone or whatever, do withdrawal management only and then push people back out on the street and say, see you later, I hope you're feeling a lot better, almost everybody relapses. And the problem with that time when you're in detox and you're locked in that inside detox, you lose tolerance, and you lose tolerance quickly. And then people get out onto the street and the vast majority, and not discharged with a nice, long, slow taper as an outpatient, they're at significantly increased risk of overdose and death, right? And we're seeing it so frequently now. And one of the major failings is that we're really not engaging with people when they come to detox into treatment and longer term medication treatment, right? It doesn't have to be lifelong, but certainly longer than 5 days, and then pushing someone out the door and then and saying good luck. So one of the major things we're recommending is that when people come to detox, that we have a very strong plan for patients, that we do a much longer taper than 5 days, because this is putting people at risk of overdose and death. And death rate right now in British Columbia is unbelievably high. You guys know this better than I do, right? I would, like, how many people in this room have lost somebody that they know, they care about, right? Everybody.
I don't know.
It's completely unacceptable. And the system of care that we have right now is contributing to that problem. And we have, you know, people that are bouncing in and out of family doctor's offices all over the province and asking for help, and accessing a healthcare system where they're really doing nothing. Problem solved. So the first recommendation is, for when you guys are going to detox, these super short tapers aren't safe, and to think about, like, hey, why are you putting me on this taper? This isn't safe. Like,
she's grabbing her water.
I should be in treatment from there, rather than just being cut off, pushed out the door, and told good luck, right?
Well, my experience with detox was the last time I was there.
A lot of couples detox?
Just let him finish his quick point, and then we'll get to that.
My experience with detox was when I was there 5.5 years ago. I went right from detox, and they asked me, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
And I said, well, I guess I'm going to go out there and do the same thing over and over again, right? Mm-hmm. Be a repeat offender on drugs. Anyways, it didn't turn out that way. They kept me there for like 10 days, and after 10 days, they had me driven from there to Maple Ridge, and I stayed there for 35 days. And from there, I went to a transition house where I was able to stay there as long as I wanted to. Mm-hmm. But I stayed there for like 18 months.
Right. Yeah. Fantastic. That's good. Yeah. That's not what happens to most people.
That's rare.
Yeah.
I got to admit, I had the support of this place to do that.
But that's a really great story, and that's the way things should work. When people want to go to treatment, they should be able to go to treatment. There should be lots of hand-holding rather than just a quick taper. You feel good. We have your holiday while you're in detox, and then you're at the door, and then you're walking back into an environment where you've lost your tolerance and you're at risk of.
But we're not your ideals, are we?
No. Well, we want to change the system of care, right?
Well, that'll be a good start. Is doing it in a way that it was perceived to me, you know, like.
Yeah.
You know,
yes.
How's that?
Yeah. Exactly.
How's that work? Okay. You're saying in a way that.
But he said he went through the whole system.
Oh. Senior cleaner is that his?
Yeah, to your program.
It's been my experience. I chaired Creekside Detox panel meetings for NA for 6 years, and biggest fear of people in there was, you know, they're just the drugs that they're on, they're getting discharged before the drugs are even tapered off out of them, right? And the other thing was that the biggest fear was going out the door without having a plan of transition. Mm-hmm. And then what happens is, because it's Fraser's Health Authority, they're only allowed to refer you to Fraser Health Authority facilities, and those ones are full. Mm-hmm. So guess what? You know, you're screwed before you even get going, because the facilities that they're going to refer you to are full of clients that haven't been discharged further from there, because there's lack of amount of beds. Like, it's just the choo-choo train crashes right there, because the gap in service right there. So then they when you come out of there, you either go left or you go right.
Yeah.
And if you go left, you're back in the pool again, right?
Yeah. And that's the problem, is that people that go back into the pool again when you've been locked away like that, you've lost your tolerance. The other thing, how many people in this room have ever been on methadone before? Lots of people, right? Almost everybody. And how many people in this room have ever heard of a medication called Suboxone?
I'm on it.
You're on it? So one of the things that we're recommending is... Yeah. One of the things that we've looked at these two medications, and they've both been studied, and they're both really good at treating opioid addiction. The problem is the system of care for methadone is not really super great, and the Suboxone is a different medication and gives the ability, because of the fact that it's way safer than methadone, it gives the ability for patients to have fewer side effects and have earlier access to caries if things are going well, because it's so much safer than methadone. So because of that, we're recommending that before we try methadone on somebody, that we try Suboxone first to see that if it treats their opiate addiction before we go on to methadone, because they're equally as good, but fewer side effects for Suboxone. And you can get to your dose that treats your addiction in 1 to 3 days, rather than slowly having to wait to get that dose with methadone. Yeah,
and you get violently ill if you decide to use opiates within that same day of doing the Suboxone.
Right.
So it's like anti-abuse for alcohol. But I wanted to say something. What people don't, I don't think anybody in this room knows this probably, but I know firsthand, like, and know, like, through my husband or someone got through what he used to be involved with, is like a lot of people don't realize a lot of the drugs, from everything from speed to heroin, they're all being cut with mental health medications like Effexor XR and all these psychotropic drugs. I don't think anybody knows that, right? Because I started, last time I detoxed off speed, really, detoxed off it about last year or 6 months ago, I've never had a detox like that in my life before. It's like I've detoxed lots of times with my own off of drugs. And this is the first time I've ever gone through the same type of detox I would go through when I missed one of my health medications for my bipolar or whatever, when I used to take prescription drugs for that stuff. And I asked my partner about it, and he told me, he's like, yeah, well, that's what they cut it with now, too. And so we're trying to make people even, the withdrawal even worse. So I don't even think detox centers are aware of that at all, that people are coming off of those as well. They don't even know that that's what's affecting them, right? Like, I don't really think anybody
what
does.
What are
those
things that you're talking about?
What?
Like, what are all those things you're talking about?
Well, like Seroquel, Effexor, anything.
I thought it was just fentanyl.
I'm just talking about in general when they try to detox. I mean, clearly are you going through the withdrawals that the carfentanil and the fentanyl is causing you now, which is really, like, brutal, but you've got to deal with these other symptoms that, you know, that I don't think people are even able to relate them to.
Yeah, they're valid issues now, and I respect that, but back to the more important points, I feel anyways, like, I just want to touch base briefly on the methadone thing. I think it's bullshit how myself and nobody who I know has been prescribed non-methadone in this lot of men have been told by the doctor or had the doctor make any effort in explaining so the person understands that when you do come off methadone, so you have to, like I wasn't told that, hey, if you ever have to come off methadone cold turkey, you just know that it's going to be, like, three times as bad as heroin. It's going to take 3 times as long. You know? And they don't tell you how, really dependent you're going to be on it. And so it doesn't seem like it's a safer alternative, and it's going to be a cushier, come down than, any other option. And it's just not, it's horrible. Like, I was on it for 2.5 years, and I came off it reducing 0.2 mils a week. This was on the new stuff. So I got down to 2.2 mils. Got released, couldn't get my welfare and pharmacare in. So I was like, I couldn't get paid for it, and I went to get bottles. So I was like, whatever, I'm a cold turkey. And I was like, 5 days in, I had a seizure, fell down a crack my skull, busted my nose, my eye was still shut. And that tooth smashed out, and so
spend more time talking
worse.
To you about the drug.
Yeah, and
what was your life like when you were on methadone? Was it better or worse?
Well, I mean, it's the difference between me and it's going to have a life or go do something, have a regular routine for
That's kind of an important point, right? Because the goal of these medications like Suboxone or Methadone is to get people to that point where you're not jonesing and, having a hard time every single day. But it's a good point. It's how do we get people off these medications and get them off safely? And for some people, they won't be able to come off the medication. And for other people, they will be able to come off the medication. And we have no really good way to know who's going to do super well when they come off the medication and who's going to relapse when they come off the medication. So what we recommend is staying in really close contact with your doctor and coming down and coming off super slow. And if you get drug cravings and feel shitty again and you feel like you're going to use again, stop, increase, or stop the taper. And then re-engage with it slowly, slowly, slowly. For some people, those drug cravings come back so strongly when they're off the medication that they'll never be able to come off the medication. But we know the most important thing, if you want to come off methadone or Suboxone, the most important thing is to do it super slowly with frequent check-ins with your doctor, right? And I agree, it gets you to a place where your life is a lot better, and then we can reevaluate and see what we need to do with getting you off the medication, but it's going to have to be done super slow because your body's going to be really dependent on that medication, right?
And then that system itself is corrupt enough that the pharmacist tries to ramp you up. You start on 60, and within a week, you're at 160.
Yeah.
You know, they're so, because what they do here is they daily dispense, right? So,
yeah.
You know, they can only charge so much for the drug, but then they can charge a dispensing fee instead of having, and then the whole system, like recovery centers that have people on some kind of script, that there's a whole little system of taxicab service that the guy will have a route, and he's delivering dope every day.
Yes, exactly.
And then the pharmacy gives a kickback to the recovery house.
We want to change that, right?
Yeah, I'd like to limit the licenses of 13 pharmacies in less than 4 square blocks.
It's really not fair. It's supposed to be, it's very clear that the medication treats opiate addiction, but the system of care that we've created where we get that medication to patients is not patient-centered.
It's supposed to be a managed care system, and it's not managed at all.
I'll tell you some of the stories that I've heard.
Sure.
See if you guys agree with this. We hear stories of, in order to get into a clinic, you have to pay $20 to $60 a month. You have to go to the pharmacist every day. They don't care. They're not doing any health care with you. You go to your doctor. There's no appointments. You have to sit there 4 hours.
Clinic fees.
Yeah, clinic fee, pharmacy fees, all these extra things are the stories that we're hearing from everybody. And they're like, yeah, methadone makes me feel better. But you want me to engage in that system of care? Those are the stories that we're hearing, and that if it were someone like me that needed access to healthcare, that would never happen. we want to change this because it's totally unfair. People recognize that this medication makes them feel better. Like you said, your life was so much better, but the system of care is
so much better, manageable.
Manageable. and so the medication is good at that, but the system of care in which we deliver that medication is not.
It's corrupt.
It's not good.
And I was saying one thing, made a really good point about how, too often, basically the doctor gives free rein over the patient's addiction in terms of running up the dosage. So it's like every week, just like, you know, it's like, it's almost baiting you in. So how are you feeling this last week? Do you want to go up again? Well, shit, I'm a fucking addict. What do you think I'm going to say, right? Like, until you get control of your addiction, of course you're going to keep up in it. And the more you're up in it, the less chance you have of really getting control of it. And it's like, yeah, that's really important. But I think there's bigger holes in the system too. Like, for example, how many guys have to go through the hell of being on the streets, be on methadone, sometimes for as long as like 5-10 years, missing an appointment or two with a doctor because I'm slipping up with a couple other drugs, and then they get arrested, go to jail, and they're like, yeah, sorry, you're not getting any methadone.
You're cut off, yeah.
What
yeah,
are you talking
this
about?
This is another
saying,
story
over
here.
10 years, what do you mean?
Yes.
2 weeks later,
yeah.
You're like, hey, what's all you say, right? So,
yeah, that's a big thing, too. Like, I was just recently in a penitentiary, and when it comes to methadone or Suboxone, they're wiping it out of the system. There, you cannot get on Suboxone there at all. And of course, it's, you know, a lot of it's because people cheeking it and it's selling it, right? But it's like, even when you are just coming in off the street, or you go to reception, or the RAC, or whatever, like, this is just talking federal, you know what I mean? It's just the same as it is from provincial, but provincial, it is more secure there. It's more, how can I say it? You know what I mean? Like, it's not very easy to distribute, you know, amongst inmates and stuff there, right? As opposed to it is in the penitentiary. But it's just like, as soon as you get there, even if you're on Suboxone or methadone, as soon as you get to the penitentiary, the first thing that they want to do is get you off of it. Because people are, you know, puking it up and, you know what I mean? And then turning around and selling it with a Suboxone thing. Like, you're cut off right away. And the doctors don't care there. They do not care.
So true.
You cannot give them any. You can give them any story. You can be walking in there, crying, dying. They do not care because of such a messed up system there. But they don't want to distribute it properly.
So you guys be happy to know we're trying to change that. Because we've had meetings with lots of doctors that work with prisons and just saying, like, guys, the same care that you get out in the community, you should be getting in corrections as well. It's totally crazy. There's tons of drugs there. People are overdosing. And the reason why there's a black market for Suboxone is because people are essentially treating their own addiction with it, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so if you get everybody who has opiate addiction and treat their addiction, it's going to be way better.
Well, it's just the same year as it is in, like, the Okanagan. Like, I was on methadone for three and a half years. I did not use in that time, but the doctors there were just the same as some of the doctors down here. They want to keep up in it. I was taking 210 mils a day.
Yeah.
Like, were you drowsy? Were you?
Oh, yeah. Like, it didn't matter. Like, when my daughter was born, I was not helping. I was not, you know what I mean? I wasn't helping the mother of my kid. You know what I mean? I go to work. I come home. I sit down for 5 minutes, I was out.
Yeah.
I was it. I was nodded off.
Yeah.
You know, or it's just like, and eventually I got so sick of being a slave to it that I did a drastic drop. I was at 210 mils. I dropped 60 mils the first week, and then I did 50 mils a week after that. And once I got down to 25 mils, I stopped for 32 hours and I went on to the Suboxone.
Oh, you did?
Okay. I did go on to Suboxone. And then eventually...
It's a better drug, right?
It is.
And it did
help because it subsided a lot of the cravings,
yeah.
A lot of the withdrawal, you know what I mean, even from the methadone. Like, Suboxone, I am very happy with Suboxone because it did help. But eventually, too, it was just another crutch. But for people that are really severe and need it, absolutely. Like, it's an amazing thing that they have that. You know what I mean? And
it saves lives, right?
It does. And, you know, when it got to the point for me, like, I had it in my head when I was coming off the methadone that Suboxone was just another crutch for me.
Yeah.
So eventually I got off of that. Yeah, I was sick, but I wasn't that sick. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I found that, I think, well, obviously I came off that way too fast.
Yeah.
And as of, you know, in a matter of not even 6 months, all it took was one tragic thing to happen to me. I was right back out there again, and I started my relapse.
So the point is, at that moment, you need to restart the Suboxone, right?
Absolutely.
So,
but I didn't.
It's hard to get in, because it's so hard. Yeah, it's true, you didn't. But that's the nature of the disease, right? We know relapsing is part of the game. And what we want to do is we want to have it like, okay, my God, something tragic has happened. I'm craving again. I want to use drugs. I want to walk into this family doctor right now and restart Suboxone. I don't want to have to wait for 3 weeks to get into a clinic because I'm going to use.
Why would you reach out to Suboxone not as opposed to like going to get counseling for it instead? Because Suboxone is made to get you off of, like, I took Suboxone myself, I bought it on the street.
Yeah.
I bought three, I got an 8, 8, and 4. After 4 years of heroin addiction, I got off for 6 months. But I did those 3 pills, that was it. Suboxone, my understanding is Suboxone is for just to get you over the sick part of it, right?
It's also for maintenance now, too.
Yeah, I know, for maintenance now, this is a money grab for the doctors, I think, personally. I don't know, that's my own personal.
Yeah, so everybody's different, and that's something we really want to we don't want everyone to be painted with the same brush.
No.
And we recognize that the reason why people use substances and lead to addiction is different for everybody,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm. I was wondering why they would go back to Suboxone. Like,
well,
that's what my understanding was about Suboxone, was that's what it was for, right? Just for that.
Yeah,
right?
So
I'd be absolutely wrong.
That's what
they were
promoting
in
the beginning.
That
yeah, I don't think they
would
want to
take
drug
free
and get
like
that.
They did, and it did for me. Like, especially coming off such, in 1 month, coming off that much methadone, and going on to Suboxone right away, it did. And it even made me feel a lot better. I wasn't so messed up off the methadone, because methadone, you know what I mean, is such a...
It can be really good for some people, though, right?
Oh, absolutely.
But your
they
story
use it for,
is kind of...
Like, I'm not complaining about it,
yeah.
Because methadone did for me what it was supposed to.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I took it the way that I was supposed to, and I didn't abuse it, and it did its job. And I'm grateful for it, because, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
A long time coming, I was using heroin for almost 10 years. Like, I've been in addiction since I was 16 years old. I'm 33.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I just coming up on 2 years clean off of everything.
Congrats.
So it comes to a point, like, when it comes to heroin, like, I was a victim, like, of the overdose from fentanyl. You know what I mean? Like, 2 years ago, or just over 2 years, I died, or sorry, no, three. Just over 3 years ago, I died 2 times from it. You know what I mean? Or overdosed.
Yeah.
Second time was more serious. You know, and I'm really lucky, right? So it's definitely not a scary thing now.
Yeah.
This is, I'm scared shitless of it.
So what's the big plan for the medical?
let's get the big plan.
So the big plan for the medical perspective is we really want to teach and train doctors how to engage with this population and how to treat addiction in an evidence-based way. So what does science tell us is best, and where does that meet patient goals? So for you guys, what do you want? And we want to make sure that we're including that in the plan, because I don't think that your voice has been heard enough for my colleagues, right? The experiences that we've heard that you guys have had, access to the healthcare system has not been good. And when people want treatment for their addiction, they have to be able to get it right away. Having to wait for it is completely unfair, especially when 2 to 3 people in British Columbia are dying every single day. So when you go and get your fracture, your broken arm fixed, and you get your antibiotics for your abscess and your infection, you should be able to get your addiction treatment at the same place. You have to go to a separate doctor who's not willing to talk to you about the other medications or your other medical problems or your housing or all the other issues you have. It's totally unfair. So what we're really hoping to do is educate doctors throughout the province. And for opiate addiction specifically, we don't want to be throwing people into a detox, quickly getting them off medication, and punting them out the door with no help. We can do this as an outpatient. You don't need to go to a detox. We can start Suboxone with your family doctor. That's what we're hoping. That's the system of care that we want. And when people need a higher level of care, we'll get people to step up to a higher level of care. And so for those people that methadone, for Suboxone doesn't work, we're recommending methadone be used after that. And there are some people where neither one of those medications are going to work for, and there's another more intensive treatment of care, which would be slow-release or once-a-day oral morphine, which would be an option, sort of an exception to the rule, but we need more, for me as a doctor, we need more tools in our toolbox, right? I tell you, for depression, for infections, for birth control, we have so many different options.
Mm-hmm.
You have too many side effects of this medication, but we need to bring your blood pressure down. We can try this, 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 or this. And we're looking at other options for treating addiction and treating opiate addiction that we know scientifically work. And we're trying to build a system of care that works for you guys so that we can treat your addiction in a way that makes you engaged with a system that makes you happy and gets you to a place that you want to be. In addition to that...
Is it necessary for some people that have ADHD to use down? Because my friend finds he is more calm than he is.
Yeah, I think that you guys will know this better than me, but I think that opiates, heroin, morphine, makes people feel very calm when they first use it, and for some people that have anxiety or ADHD, calms them in a way that nothing else has been able to calm them.
Like, he finds when he does speed, he calms down. He's more able to, like, level, not your mind.
Desire makes me go to sleep.
It, like, levels him out.
Yeah, yeah. So that might be true for some people, for sure, and it would be really important for them to get into a doctor to see about other treatment that could potentially treat their ADHD. But I think the reason why people use, you guys know this, of course, better than I do, too, but just from talking to all my patients and working in the industry for so long, the reason why people use substances varies so greatly. Some people have, their genetics have wired them in a way to love whatever it is that they tried. I remember being friends with people when I was 14 and having a friend of mine try alcohol. I didn't like it. And my friend tried it and he loved it. It was the greatest thing that he'd ever tried. And those are genetics, right? Like, your genes, you're wired in a way to really, really like these things. And that's true of opioids and benzos and Valium and all these other drugs as well, right? Some people love speed the first time they ever tried it. And it's just like, they're done. They're down the rabbit hole. Other people, they can try it and take it or leave it.
He subscribes to the belief that it's
I do
allergy.
Everything.
Not that it's an allergy. Like that's sort of like from the big book, from the AA. It's like your it's an allergy for your body. Like, I think because I'm a medical doctor, the way we define allergies is different. I think when you're not in medicine, you maybe when you're not like a scientist like this, you define an allergy a little bit differently. But I would agree that everybody's body responds to these drugs, substances, medications, whatever, differently. Some people have genetics that when you drink alcohol, you get sick and you don't like it. You know, that's a genetic predisposition to being protected from addiction, right? Some people have their genetics wired in a way that if they're going to try a substance, they love it. And we know that in men and women, addiction affects them differently, and in different families and different ethnic groups, and then your family, your environment in which you're brought up, right? Some the history of trauma, mental illness, all these different things, all that coming together to put people at a huge risk of substance use leading to addiction. So I just wanted to say that we recognize that each one of you are totally different. Each one of us are totally different, and the system of care that we have to get, we have to be able to treat people where they're at and provide services for everybody.
Treat
in
people
huge,
where they're at.
In the whole spectrum, and make it as safe and effective for everybody. And that's our goal.
What are you going to do about training doctors on how much medication to give out? I mean, like, some doctors I've heard of love their patients on morphine, on morphine, methadone, because it makes them money and it keeps them coming to that doctor, right? I mean, like, it is a moneymaker, methadone and what's that other one?
It is true, so I agree with you that doctors get paid to not necessarily to prescribe these medications, but we don't get paid to prescribe drugs. So what we do get paid is we get paid to see you.
Yeah.
And it is true, there's a perception for sure, and I'm not here to protect my colleagues in any way. There is a perception, though, that doctors get paid for the prescriptions that they write. We don't at all. But I think that the system of care that we have, in particular for methadone, is so bad that it can't possibly look like, from a patient's point of view, that it must be that the doctors are getting paid. And we do get paid to see you. But there's so much work out there that, I mean, I don't think that it's necessary. Like, doctors definitely not getting paid to write these prescriptions.
No, I understand that.
But in some
cases.
I got a couple questions.
No, I lost my train of thought.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Keith.
Okay, I guess, you know, you're saying treat people where they're at, right? So we need more outreach teams in the community. There's nothing down here coming on a regular basis. And by the time, you know, you don't even need to send an ambulance. Just set up a trailer, you know? The other thing is that there's barriers at Surrey Memorial Hospital with the security subcontractor that once they identify you as a substance user, that they'll escort you off the property.
That's crazy.
There's also Emerge team doctors that Jeff, just last week or the week before, when it's your story, like when they kicked you out of Emerge and you were like going down.
Yeah, it was.
I already talked about last week when I overdosed.
Well, this is when you talk about it now. They can hear it.
They can do that?
Listen.
2 weeks ago, I was finally ill again. And after 3 hours, I was told that it was all in my head and they kicked me out of there. And then last week, I had the same doctor when I overdosed, and he kicked me out after about 4 or 5 hours. And when I was still fucking very much out of it.
Okay.
And shouldn't be. And escorted off property by security.
Well,
so 3 years ago, we lit up that hospital like a Christmas tree with an undercover team of SANSU members that went in there, and the intake nurses used to wait and see if they could time us out that we would leave before we would get services. So we waited, and we filmed it. And we also filmed, interviewed 9 SANSU members, and then we made a disc and sent it all the way up to the CEO of Fraser Health. The following year, our funding was cut. So, and then 2 years, just last year, they have 4 people on a team now that once you're identified as a substance user, that they come down and they follow the doctor and the nurse and the eMERGE team. And then while they're doing it, they're also phoning for addiction counseling, psychiatry, whatever else, right? That's what they're supposed to be doing. And this is what I'm hearing now, just 2 weeks ago, after we had the nurse stand in our SANSU meeting a year ago, saying all has changed, and for a period of time it had, but now we're falling back into that rut where the old school boys are still running the roost, and everybody's getting like indoctrinated into that old school thinking, where the new school should be kicking these guys and come to early retirement. See ya.
That's a real problem. And Jeff, is it?
Yeah.
Jeff, when you were at Surrey Memorial and when you overdosed, did anybody talk to you or offer you any form of treatment for it, or ask you if you wanted to?
I didn't have anybody following the doctor around.
Yeah. So this is my question.
I asked for a glass of water like a couple hours after I got there, and they didn't give me nothing until they told me that I had to leave, and then they gave me my glass of water. Again, as I was leaving in, I told him to go fuck himself.
So my question is, in this manual, or are you going to put a section for doctors for identifiers so that they can identify a substance user that, you know, you go down a short list, okay? You know, and we now have identified this particular patient or as a substance user, and we have to treat this person as such. It's fallen down the pachinko board down into this corner, and this is what we need to do, because when they're not properly identified, or if the doctor is oblivious or doesn't see it, it's coming because of what's being generated with the drugs. It's going to be in your backyard. Like, no one really gave a crap until the little girl in Maple Ridge went down in fentanyl in a Starbucks bathroom. Then it hit the media like a blazing fire. We on that same day we had 5 overdoses on this street. The very same day.
Yeah, they don't see.
And they're dropping like flies, and it's not newsworthy anymore. The shock therapy's gone. So it's the burbs, and somebody in Kelowna or Prince George or someplace up north, right? When it says, oh, the drugs have got that far now, right? It's all, by that time, there's thousands of people in body bags. And that's what we've been screaming like this for 6 years about this, right?
I have Newton paper there.
The Surrey Now?
The Now. I did an interview with him on exactly what we're talking about here, people overdosing, a year and a half ago, and it's only come to public eye now, in the last 6 months. I mean, like, that's totally ridiculous. And I told him, I gave an exact figure. I said, by the end of this year, there'll be 800 people that will have dropped dead. And I guarantee you, it'll go well over that by the end of this year. That's by the end of December.
Yeah, 4 weeks.
Yeah,
you know, and why was that story about that guy that a couple in North Vancouver more important than the people dying on the strip here?
Yeah, exactly.
Why?
Well, we understand why, but okay, let's move on to some more questions.
I really, hearing these stories from you guys is really valuable for us, because We need all this to change, right? And Jeff, I'm so sorry that was your experience there. And we're really hoping that we can change the system of care. And although you know at St. Paul's, and we're hoping that what we're doing at St. Paul's will really change, we've got the largest addiction medicine training program in all of North America now. So one of the main problems is that when I went through medical school, in my 15 years of school, of like pre-med and medical school and post-medical training and all this stuff, 1 hour of training until I went in like really, one hour on addiction, right?
One hour on addiction,
which is like a small component of addiction has led to 800 deaths this year. And so, you know, any other disease we would have had, you know, a month dedicated to it. So we're trying to change that. And so it is slow and, you know, steady, but we're making a big difference, I think, and a big difference is like listening to your stories and learning from you guys so that we can change this. And I think the biggest part about being a doctor in this field really is just being nice.
I understand, you know? But you're with Coastal Health, right?
Yeah, with Providence Health.
This is Fraser Health we're talking about. Yeah. And that's a whole different entity.
I know,
It is. Who are you going to get to train these people?
Well, we're doing it. So the people that are coming up here.
Here's the good part. Here we go.
So the people that are coming out to work here are coming through and training. There are people that have come through our program specifically that have come out here to, and are trying to make change in Fraser Health. And I know that change is slow. I wish that we could change.
We don't have time.
I know, man. I agree with you completely.
We don't
have
time.
I wish that we could change the system.
We're finding body bags all over the street.
Yeah.
We don't have time to wait for you guys to get organized. We need to do something now.
Yeah, I agree. And there was this big opioid summit in Ottawa recently.
Yes.
And, you know, it is so bad right now in BC and Surrey and downtown Vancouver, all over the Vancouver Island. It is so bad right now. And man, it just breaks my heart. I wish we could make changes so much faster. It's a very complicated problem though, right? Like it's,
Well, it was funny because Christy Clark made the comment, you know, about fentanyl and weed, right? And you know what? She's right. It's just that VPD hasn't seized a bag yet. And I said to Ron, I said, why don't you go buy a bag, throw some fentanyl in it, shake it up, and throw it on their doorstep. There's your seizure. Just because they haven't found it yet.
That's
you know,
scary.
Like it's in everything. Don't kid yourself. It's like everything. So, you know, we're warning kids. You know, like your pot you're smoking, you know, you better be watching what you're smoking because, or you better see the plant that it's come from. Because I said, if you buy a bag off somebody you don't know, your chances are that it's laced.
Yeah.
You know, they did that with crystal meth.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, in my day, we used to spray weed with Coca-Cola. You know, when we hung it, we used to spray with Coca-Cola, make it nice and sticky. And that's where, you know, it's like, you know, you weighed more and you have to pay more and it was good. Yeah, that's what we used to do and I used to crop out, you know, and make huge money. And then now, you know, then I got out and then it's crystal meth. And I'm on, you know, and then now it's fentanyl. You know, like, you know, really.
Carpet, no.
And
I
know 12 and 13-year-olds are using crystal meth now.
Oh, yeah.
It's disgusting.
Not. Yeah.
What are we doing about the educations to the school programs about fentanyl?
And they just put Narcan kits in every single elementary school in, like, Canada, didn't they?
Well, no. I think that some people want them there and some people don't want them there.
It was on the news.
You know, what I remember in high school, we went through this whole debate with condoms as well. It's like,
yeah. You
know, people are having sex.
Having
condoms around is probably a good idea. But we're going through the same debate right now with parents and principals about whether or not, how we should be educating kids. And I obviously believe that we need to be in schools and letting them know what's going on.
I think these people with disabilities,
it's not a political football. It's a medical issue.
I agree.
It's
the ones with the disabilities,
sorry, Mr. Politician.
Right?
Just stroke the check, and we'll implement all the things that we need to implement as a medical model.
Yeah,
and we'll probably save your daughter.
Yeah,
you
know? I agree.
I mean, why is the government getting involved now?
Why are they getting involved now?
It seems to me like they're looking for a loophole to where they can make money on it.
No, it's so expensive to treat addiction, right? Or not to treat the consequences of addiction, to treat HIV, to treat hepatitis C, to treat overdoses and hospitalizations and infections. Treating addiction is way cheaper. Way cheaper. So if you want to make the argument around like what makes more financial sense from a society, it's like harm
That's
reduction and treatment for addiction saves tons of money. And so politically, though, there are so many people out there that don't understand addiction, right? They think that it's all hedonistic and voluntary for people, and it's just a big party.
Just stop.
And, yeah, just stop. It's just stop. And then, so, like, they need to come down here and see, like,
it's not
to
a
me, it's clear that this does not look like fun.
No.
Right?
It's not a choice.
It does not look like fun. This is not something anybody would say to themselves, that I need to just hang out under a tarp.
I know. That
and in the pouring rain in Vancouver in January, right? So, I get it. I spent enough time talking. The voting population don't understand addiction, right?
Yeah.
They don't understand addiction. And
they need to have the breakdown of this is what it costs for the taxpayer for an ambulance call. This is what it costs the taxpayer for an attending officer.
A hospital
visit. This is the cost that it costs for an eMERGE team. This is your eMERGE team doctor. This is what your bed costs for 3 nights for an addict to sit in. There's the nurse to put the IV in her hourly wage. And by the way, this is what you're paying for one service, for one addict, for one relapse, or for one overdose.
Yeah, exactly.
That's when you need to break it down,
and
right?
Compared
and
to
how much do you spend
on production,
RCP and their guns and whatever else, you know, the proportion is crazy.
Yeah, it's crazy.
You know, Mark Hayden is a really good supporter of SANSU, and I followed him from day one, and then before him was... he's the drug policy coordinator for Vancouver. He was
Don McPherson.
That was the first guy I went and met, and then now he's Kaput or whatever.
Yeah, he's Canadian.
National Canadian,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So those are two really great people that are doing very important work, right?
Oh yeah.
And those are two people that understand the problem, and you get.
You know what? And then there's another one called The Blueprint. It's a book. And I'll send you the link. And what it was is it was a multi-million-dollar guy or a millionaire in England, and he just commissioned a guy to write for a year. If, you know what, everybody said, okay, we give up the war on drugs, you know, we'll give up. Okay, what's the blueprint that would look like it to make it work, make it functional? You know, like, you know, dispensaries and legalized, prescription heroin and, you know, like different things like that. Like, what would it look like? And he wrote a book and it's brilliant. Yeah, I'll send you the link on it. You
can
read it. It's a deadly book. Yes, down the hall to the left.
Thank you. Sorry.
Is the Naomi project still in progress?
So, the Naomi was a trial that finished years ago, and it compared those people that didn't do well on methadone compared to. They randomized people to prescription heroin versus staying on methadone. It's actually like a 7th or 8th international trial that have supported people that don't do well on methadone do well on prescribed heroin. Following that trial, another like 7th trial, they have prescribed heroin available in places, other places in the world, as a treatment, not just a study like we've had in Vancouver. Our federal government said, you know what, we're not going to do prescribed heroin. We're not going to make it available to anybody. So we did another study. Where the researchers looked at, okay, prescribed heroin versus prescribed hydromorphone, which is we can prescribe in Canada, and actually people can tell the difference between the two of them.
Yeah.
So I think people have their preference for whatever drug they want to do, but when they were blinded and didn't know what they were using, they couldn't tell the difference. So the only point in doing that study was actually to see if the drug that we can prescribe is equal to the drug that had been studied much before, and it turns out they're exactly the same.
Yeah.
So the change in our federal government and the access to heroin is changing because we have a federal health minister who's a physician, who's a doctor, family doctor, and a researcher, and kind of gets this whole issue.
Okay.
So the Naomi was a trial, finished. Salome was the second trial, it's done. Now there's a crosstown clinic, but they have no resources. So there's 120 people in that clinic getting injectable. But there's many more people that could benefit from that treatment. There's also tens of thousands of people that could benefit from Suboxone or Methadone as well, right? So we just, like, the fact that you go to detox and have to wait 3 weeks to 3 months to get into a specialty clinic to get Methadone is totally wrong and completely unfair. And as a family doctor, we need to be able to provide this access, this care for everybody in the area.
Thank
you guys. We're gonna head out.
Cool. Thanks for having us.
You guys
do the scan.
Yeah.
We'll check it out again.
Well, they SANSU's here all the time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not all the time.
See that poster on the calendar there?
Yeah.
You see that in the positive point, or this room, or in the
yeah.
in the front room? That's where it'll be. That's how we split up the posters.
This is where you guys meet. Right?
Yeah.
How often?
So 7 p.m.
About once or twice a month.
Maybe we'll come check you out again.
I think
you
should.
Maybe we'll smoke a cigarette and come back.
Yeah, do that.
Thanks for coming. So let's
round this up. We'll go around the room, and knowing that what we've sort of had a conversation surrounding, we'll just go around, and if anybody has some final comments or quick questions, we'll try and work our way around the room as quickly as possible. So, Brad, are you awake, or are you kind of not?
I'm listening.
Okay, knowing what's just been said in this room today, right, is there any comment you want to throw in there? You want to ask Narupa or Keith or something you want to say, to your sports fans across Canada, you know?
What exactly, as far as like influence towards these governing bodies, and what was your voice in it?
So good question.
Yeah.
I think that's probably one of the most important things, right? And our current provincial minister of health is really, really excited about the work that we're doing and completely wants to change the system of care. It's going to take a lot of time, and the frustrations that you guys are expressing to us aren't going to go away tomorrow, right? But our current government and our regulatory body, the College of Physicians and Surgeons, and the nursing regulatory body, the pharmacy regulatory body, they are all on board with what we're doing at the BC Centre on Substance Use. They want us to change the system of care for you guys so that we can start seeing better health outcomes.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. Jen?
After you get out of detox and you say you have to wait 3 months.
Something
for
to do, right?
To go on. Because I'm supposed to go like in 2 days. I've never been before.
You want a quick side?
Yeah, I was just assuming that, like, after, like, if they put you on methadone or suboxone there, that would continue once you were done.
Exactly. So what I would recommend
to you...
There's
a lapse in there?
No, there shouldn't be. So what I would recommend to you is when you go there, that you tell them that you want to go on longer-term medication, that you're not here for a quick taker, that you want to go on longer-term medication, you want access to a methadone or suboxone. I would try and go on suboxone first. That you want access to a suboxone doctor when you leave Creekside Detox. And there's a new program just outside Creekside Detox. I think it's called Detox. I don't know the actual name of it. Quibble Creek, I think. They have suboxone doctors there now where you don't have to pay a clinic fee. And so I would say to them right when you go and see the doctor and the nurses, say, you know what, I'm here to go on longer-term maintenance for a while, and I want to go to treatment.
Right.
Make that your goal when you go there and let them know, because if you get tapered off quickly, it's super dangerous because you're going to leave and most people relapse, right?
Yeah.
And you want to like stay on medication until you get your life to a really good place and then slowly come off medication and stay in quick, close contact with your doctor.
Okay.
So when you go there, tell them your plan. You're like, I'm here to get on Suboxone and I need a Suboxone doctor when I leave and I want to go on maintenance and I want to go to treatment and I want to get better, and then that's my plan. Jeff, I'm so sorry about your story, man. I'm embarrassed that you were treated like that by my colleagues.
It's happened to me every time I've gone down to that hospital.
Yeah.
I've had nothing but bad looking things happen to me.
Yeah, I'm sorry, man. I'm really sorry.
It is what it is.
Well, I hope it is a change.
In my experience, I found Vancouver Coastal Health far more avant-garde than Fraser Health. They seem like a slow tugboat that's sort of trying to keep up to the sort of people that are cutting edge and that are a little more tied into UBC and just sort of, you know, they kind of, you know, parley themselves with SFU, but there's in the amount of seminars they put on, you know, there's one all the time, you know, on one topic or another.
There's no supervised consumption site out here.
Neither is Manitoba, so what the hell, right?
What's the big kahuna called, like BC Health or Canada Health?
No, it's the big kahuna is OHIP, isn't it?
That's Ontario.
Yeah.
But, you know, you should...
Even VHA has a little bit more on the ball.
Yeah, you guys should be optimistic, though, because... What we're doing through the BC Centre on Substance Use, it'll be a centre, but the the point is it for really to be a network across the province.
Right, a feeder, a central hospital for a bunch of feeders.
There are leads in each health authority now. There's a lead in Fraser Health we're working really closely with, and a lot of the people that are coming and doing training with us are coming out and working in Fraser, and they're bringing out this model of care. So we're not going to see immediate change tomorrow. Change is slow, but guys, I want you to know that
the ball
Jeff,
the play.
In the future, our goal is for you not to be treated like that. Right?
Yeah. But we, you know, I'll tell you, all this, what's going on here tonight can be all, you know, seen on the Sansu, right?
I think I need to get drugs, but didn't expect to go to a meeting. You know, that's great.
There you go. Yeah. And pizza.
That's why I said this is not productive about you.
Are you sure we can't do this more than once?
At least I'm being honest.
Yeah, well, you know what?
Just,
you know, just keep screaming at Fraser Health or somebody that, you know, that will
respond.
I would like to do it every week.
Thank God.
But, you know, for me, I mean, I work a day job, and I come here in my time, and, you know, when there's no... I've been clean for 12 and a half years, since May 22nd, 2004.
Is there anything?
All the time. You want to come to a meeting? There's one in this room on Thursday nights, my home group.
Well,
7 o'clock.
Good.
I don't know. Come and find out. But it's not about that. Sansu is, you know, Sansu can be about all sorts of things. Education, harm reduction... You know, peer-to-peer engagement, you know, this is what it's all about. But there's a lot of stuff available, and that's what was on the bottom of the little questionnaire, the little membership, right? What is going to make you light up? What are you interested in, right? Mm-hmm. And one day you might come, and Sansu is about as exciting as wallpaper paste, and then the next time you come, it's like, wow, man, there's some stuff there I really learned.
And we met a bunch of people.
Exactly. Because individually, no one wants to listen to you, but guess what? When you have 300 plus people, and they're all saying the same thing, and then I take the information and say, guess what? I take the people that need to, that are talking about us, but not, don't want to talk to us. Guess who's in the room tonight? People who want to talk with us.
Exactly. And it's great to hear everyone's
input. And that's when you're going
to
get real information, and from the front line, from the marginalized most marginalized population in the world.
Thanks for you guys to come out.
And that, then you can build from there, because who are you trying to treat?
It shows that you guys care.
So we asked some people that we want to treat. What would you look like? What would treatment look like to you?
It'd be cool to get more of those people in here.
Right from the source, right?
Exactly.
Right
well, you
guys.
Don't want to have a bunch of people.
It's
you
cool
know,
that you talk, right?
What about him? I'll ask him
and let them
make
cake, you know?
Hey, guys, thank you all for sharing your stories with us.
No, thank you for coming.
You know, it's all such great learning for us, and you're the reason that we continue to do the work that we do, so thank you all for coming tonight and sharing your stories.
Thank you for coming. Thank you. For round of applause. Now, it's customary at Sansu at the end of the meeting, we remove our headwear, we stand, and we have a moment of silence for the people who have paid the ultimate price, though.
Okay, good.
We have the ultimate price, paid the ultimate price. If you have any friends that have fallen, please take this time now to just mention their name.